Welcome to the On the Health Record podcast, where we talk about the current state and future trends in healthcare. We are passionate about our EHR solutions and helping to simplify the business of healthcare. Tune in for interviews with product experts, key partners, and other leaders in the healthcare industry. I'm super excited to welcome onto the podcast Dr. Andrew Barbash. Hi, Dr. Barbash. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about yourself and your journey in the medical field?
Yeah, well, I'm 70 years old. I recently retired, actually, as a clinical neurologist. Yep. I originally had no idea I was going to go into medicine and thought I was going to go into business. But then took a program after college where I did my pre-med work and decided ultimately during medical school to go into the field of neurology. So I finished my medical school at Northwestern, and I did my neurology at the Mayo Clinic. And then I've been a big believer in sort of efficiency and operational efficiency in healthcare ever since I've been exposed to it. Maybe that's the value of coming out of a non-medical family. And I got a lot of experience with that at the Mayo Clinic, which I think it gets carried with me through my career. I worked for in private practice for a couple of years, and then went to join the staff of Kaiser Permanente in the Mid-Atlantic area. I'm a very big believer in sort of organized healthcare delivery systems, of which that is obviously one of the premier and earliest ones. During that period of time, for about 12 years, I got involved in electronic medical records. I'm not a technical coder. I've never written a line of code in my life, but I've been very, very interested from early on in the role that, sort of computerized electronic communication, et cetera, would play in transforming care for both providers and patients and the systems in general. So I ended up leading the effort in the Mid-Atlantic area around their electronic record with Kaiser before they went to Epic. And then afterwards, I decided I wanted to do some sort of inpatient program type of work. So I developed and ran the neuroscience program at a community hospital for about 4 or 5 years. And then during that time, I actually also got a lot more exposure to just overall communications, some early video chat, virtual care, sort of telehealth, file sharing, et cetera, in the context of the work we were doing. And spent the last 10 years of my career doing full-time telemedicine for a large enterprise that was providing acute stroke care. And I was particularly involved in developing out some of the inpatient routine care on a virtual model as well, across, 26 states and multiple hospitals, et cetera. And that's where I ended up my career. After 38 years, I decided that it was enough.
Thank you for sharing. And throughout your career as a seasoned neurologist, I'm sure you worked with many different patients and different health systems, yeah?
Yes, yes, very. And particularly doing work in telemedicine where it's interesting. At Kaiser, I was part of a single global integrated health system. Even though they had multiple regions throughout the country, most of our care was, limited to one area. But even there, when I was overseeing the electronic record, we had 25 different medical centers from Baltimore down to Virginia, into DC, and in various parts of Maryland. And so we were interacting with many different kinds of environments and demographics, even within this umbrella of the healthcare system. And when I got into doing telemedicine, of course, by definition, the nature of that service was to interact with patients and providers in multiple states, multiple hospitals, multiple different healthcare systems that those hospitals were part of. And some of the hospitals were just independent facilities.
And how do you feel about the native communication tools that are traditionally available within EHRs based on your experience?
Well, it's all been a moving target. And so I think that, I think it's difficult to put a stake in the ground and comment on what it was like 10 years ago. But I think, fundamentally, most of the electronic medical records, some are more focused on communication than others, are generally deal with sort of basic outreach to patients, basic sending out selective information to patients, perhaps having a patient portal. It's very, very, it's very sort of patient to practice specific in that relationship. And then and some of them are better. Most of them actually deal with inbound faxing and how faxes come into what the workflow is of receiving faxes, because that's a still mainstay very common, popular, high volume activity for information that's sent into the practice from anywhere, and the practice has to grapple with that. I don't think most EMRs have spent a lot of focus on exactly how all that workflow has to be optimized, but they certainly have addressed the challenge of, taking a document, however it's generated, attaching it to a patient and filing and putting it in the appropriate place. A lot of the EMRs have gotten more into outbound reminders, appointment reminders, related to either disease conditions or individual patient appointments, and then increasingly more of them have been involved in embedding the ability to do telehealth and video chat, et cetera. So I think it's fair to say that it's a moving target. The focus it emanates from the EHR, which is practice centric, and it's generally every patient as an individual entity within that electronic record. They have their own chart, and so most of the communication is basically from the chart or the practice to the patient and vice versa, which is a little different than looking globally. And then, of course, some of the native EMRs that are part of larger systems have also gotten into, basic messaging and secure mail between providers.
Yeah, I can see how the tools available within EHRs can be convenient, but not expansive enough sometimes. Have you found that certain tasks or areas where additional communication tools are actually more effective or can help you as the practice go the extra mile, if you will?
Yes, I actually think the managing of faxing is actually a very good example, and that is that it's really valuable to be able to take when you've gotten to the point where you have a document or whatever it is, or results, or report, or a summary, a consult note from an outside specialist, or lab results from a pharmacy request, whatever it happens to be. It's great that you can take that and then you can address it, whether it's refilling a medication or filing it in the chart or storing it and linking it to the referral request that was made, for example. But the issue about how one is grappling with the content that's coming into the practice before you get it to the point where you want to take it and put it away is a whole different animal altogether. And that's actually an area that I had gotten involved in early on in sort of helping, looking at developing some solutions or seeing what other people had done to try to take advantage of them. The other thing is that is inter-provider communication really has to get beyond the level of just the practice itself or even just the EMR system itself if it crosses multiple practices, because by definition, in order to be effective, you can't be constrained and limited by the security and privacy and login password requirements, having people to set up separate accounts for separate each system, et cetera. And I think that's a particular challenge. So what I see is there's a layer of communication that really kind of needs to sit above and beyond, like a layer of the stratosphere. It's to sit above and beyond the practice itself, even though the people within the practice, they want to live and work within their practice, but particularly inter-provider communication. And then the other is that what seems like it might be the most convenient thing for the practice or members of the practice to do to reach out to a patient or another provider or family member, the method that they may want to use. They went, oh, I want to take everything and push it to the patient portal. That it's not necessarily actually the optimal way for the patient to actually then receive it and then actually interact back. So I think there is a lot of value in and again in looking at a layer of communication that kind of sits above and beyond the practice and their EMR itself that can grapple with the flexibility, different languages, I want to send you out a secure text, but you want to basically send me back a less secure text because that's more convenient for you and you don't really care as much, or you'd rather email or fax, et cetera. And so I think kind of getting to taking a focus where you're really unifying the kind of workflow around communication has a lot of value because of the different needs and priorities of the different players that are actually involved. That's just practice. That's with between the practices and the patient, between practices and other providers, between providers. And then, of course, there's communication within the practice itself, which is an area that most EMRs have actually done a better job of focusing on, internal messaging. But then connecting those two phenomena versus is a challenge.
And what are your favorite communication tools that you use?
Well, it's interesting. I was a big fan of just secure messaging tools. When I can assure you, when I was doing telemedicine, one of my first questions was, "Oh, does your hospital use Epic or Epic Chat, or do you use Tiger Text, or are you on your own Perfect Server, or Doc Halo?" I didn't really care. I was a specialist, and what I knew was I was going to have to interact with people in various different places, and what I knew I couldn't do is have the unique login to each one of these 150 different systems. That's ridiculous. And so it was. I loved it. Anytime a hospital would say, "Well, we use any one of these following," as I said, I give you a list of five, six, seven, eight, commercially available utilities that have a mobile app. They have a notifier. They're not complicated, et cetera. My feeling was, wow, if I'm going to see patients for you virtually, and I want to deal with follow-up care, not just doing a video consult. Sure, how do we connect? And unfortunately, the way that most of these systems are developed and sold and marketed, and the way the contracts are done, is they are often requires a specific configuration. Like you have to be configured. In some situations, you actually have to be given an email address at a particular hospital in order for their version of the secure messaging tools to work. I found all that extremely frustrating. And so, and I obviously I was, I'm very familiar with Updocs, for example. I've used, many, many different kinds of methods to communicate. The same thing applies to video chat. The last couple of years, obviously, everybody uses Zoom. But I've been very familiar with GoToMeeting and video, and I'm making Teams, you name it. And so my feeling was that as over time, it's becoming, these are a little bit more generalized. They're more similar. And so my feeling was if you as a health system, this is what you use and you use it regularly. And if you've actually chosen something that makes it fairly easy for us, me and my colleagues to interact with you without some very convoluted configuration, tell me what it is. Let's do a test communication with each other. And in the field of telemedicine, doing video chat was one thing that's often tied to actually to video cards, et cetera, not always. But the basic process of just fundamentally securely communicating through your mobile device or your desktop, whatever, being able to find people in groups because you don't necessarily know who's covering one day or the other. Knowing that the nurses are actually carrying mobile messaging devices, not just the doctors, really important. Mid-level's the same. When that's actually working, it completely transforms the efficiency and sense of safety and comfort of actually providing care in a more virtual model. And whether it's a practice interacting with their own patients, whether it's a practitioner interacting with other specialists or other primary care, other providers and other practices, or whether or not somebody doing a specialty service and providing them to multiple institutions, that issue of just basic reliable communication is so profoundly important. And once you have experienced it, regardless of what the particular tool is, there is absolutely no going back. And I got to the point where if it was up to me, I wouldn't sign a contract to do telemedicine consults with a hospital if I couldn't actually reliably message, and vice versa, the people that I was going to interact with. I just simply wouldn't do it.
So it seems like there are definitely some pros and cons to an all-in-one communication system that is part of an EHR. Is that correct?
Yes, yeah.
Awesome.
I think in general, the just like a lot of other aspects of technology, the basic technical aspects of these things are really becoming a little bit more generic and more ubiquitous. I think one of the challenges with the sort of all-in-one communication is that most people, they complain about the limitations of whatever they're given to use. They'll complain about it, rightfully so, because, oh, I can't do this. I wish I could. But then if they're actually provided with a broad toolkit, it's overwhelming. And they go, well, I don't want to think about all the ways I could interact with a patient. Just tell me the hit the blue button, and that's the way a message goes to the patient portal, and I'll just hope that everybody responds. And so it's achieving that balance between what the individual kind of how much thought and accountability they really want to take on if they're provided with tools that allows them to really do many things with many different people in different ways.
And I assume it would take time to learn a new system, to train a team. Like, there are some aspects of just getting up to date, as well as the price. Like, if you were to look into additional communication tools on top of what you are already getting through an EHR, it's an additional cost that a practice needs to take on, as well as the training and information to understand the value of what they're being able to use these tools as.
When we were signing, when we would start seeing consults for a different hospital or new hospital, for example, and as soon as someone says, "Oh, this is great, we use Epic or good or whatever it is," and we just need you two guys to do the 2-hour training, I just stop. I go, it's not that I don't want to do. Why in the world would you think that it is reasonable to be using systems that for the basic communications requires 2 hours of training? I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't download anything like that from Amazon. I mean, you've got to be kidding. And so the reality is that even though a lot of these systems have a lot of complex tools, et cetera, you should be able to literally say to somebody, "Hey, we use Tiger, we use this, or we use that. I want you to go here, click this. By the way, you're going to immediately get the message that I actually am conveying to you, and maybe 2 minutes of trying to figure it out, and that's it." And I don't think that's why healthcare communication should tolerate, complex training sessions, et cetera, whereas in order to communicate with your financial advisor, you click on a link and create a username. I don't get that at all. So I think that there's a lot of benefit to having healthcare, people in healthcare just think of themselves as being involved in a professional service that's tracking data with clients, handling things in a private, robust, private and flexible way. And in reality, the security and privacy around your health information, why is that any more complicated than your banking data? I mean, it just, so it's as we start thinking more generically about that, I believe we will find that the tools that are developed that look at communication in a generic way, the kind of the light bulb goes off and one realizes how efficient it can be.
As an individual practice, to know and be proficient in key communication tools that your practice can easily use, easily onboard, and then utilize to converse with patients, other practices, hospital systems, pharmacies, all of that good stuff, then you guys are basically put in the driver's seat. You can
That's
control
right.
and make sure that everything is happening on time and efficiently, et cetera. And you kind of are in charge of your own destiny, if you will, as opposed to needing logins, information about all these other systems that you're working with, all of that type of stuff. Is that the case?
Yes, that is true. And certainly during the pandemic, as a lot of, I did a lot of work actually with some practices for the underinsured, let's say, the need to migrate to a way from just purely reliant on in-person communication, not just for visits, but for everything. Pre-visit, post-visit surveys, results management, et cetera, was so profound that most people began to realize you had to move away from this assumption that, well, you know, I'm a healthcare practice. We don't text. We don't use email. You know, we can't email us. Or you, and you know, the patients would say, well, then I how are we going to communicate? And the reality is the need to be comfortable that you can engage your patients and they will engage, et cetera, really kind of forces people to open their eyes a little bit and realize, wow, you know, we need to be able to engage people the way that they want to engage, you know, and that's where texting, this was particularly important. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, we need to have tools that if we know that we have something that needs to be handled a little bit more privately, a little bit more securely, I need to be able to do that without the patient having to do anything terribly different. Yeah. And that sounds all high and mighty, but it's not necessarily that easy to figure out. But if you do figure it out, it's golden. And mm-hmm. So it's and again, all of this is moving, but there's no question to me that many people, if you expose them to a whole variety of, it's a really broad toolkit of how to communicate, you know, from faxing to broadcasting to texting to secure texting to email to voice to translators, yes or no, if you put all that together, a lot of people are kind of overwhelmed and go, oh, just show me, you know, what's the one thing what's the one way I'm supposed to communicate with that pharmacy or this pharmacy? Mm-hmm. And it's sad, you know, that it's kind of a comfort zone. And until you realize that you now have to interact and communicate with multiple pharmacies and multiple people, multiple ways, you realize that wow, I really need a broader set of tools. And there's an area when you talk about training, I do think that there's an area of expertise that everybody in healthcare could benefit from, which is to really develop a communication strategy that thinks mm-hmm. about all the entities that they interact, that person interacts with, that their team interacts with, their practice mm-hmm. interacts with, and to be cognizant of what those other people need to be doing, that they need to interact, et cetera. And then I think as people start thinking differently and looking at the tools that are available differently, you can get to a much better place. And ultimately, the cost of these kinds of systems starts looking minimal because this time that's being saved is just so, so phenomenal.
Yeah. I mean, even if you were to see let's say 6 patients in a day and each of them have a different pharmacy that you then need to contact and take notes, the benefit of, you know, technology these days is that is something that you can get done within 10, 15 minutes. If it's all on one screen, you have records up in front of you on your computer instead of physically calling the 6 pharmacies, you know, looking through handwritten notes, then faxing and all of these things. I mean, technology these days is there to help practices be efficient with the time that they are spending throughout the day that isn't face-to-face with the patient, right? Like that is the goal.
That is exactly right. Faxing is a good example. Again, I'm not focusing on faxing too much, but the reality is, if you think, what is faxing? It's the ability for one person or one entity to say, hey, Sammy, Shirley, send those records to that practice or whatever it is, right? And that person could say, oh, does the person ever say, oh, excuse me, is it more than 50 pages? Because that's a lot of work for the person receiving it. They might have to, no, it's not even given a thought. Take it, shove it in the machine, off it goes, right? You have literally pushed a button, walked away and gone to get coffee. That machine is working, chugging along, and it is generating work on the other end that could take hours.
Yeah.
And nobody is paying the people receiving it to do the work. It's real. I mean, we could have an entire podcast just on the phenomenon of faxing and how absurd it is, right?
Yeah.
But it's also probably the most ubiquitously available, and still there's a reason faxing still exists, actually, right? I think another example is, I think there are many people in practices that are very reluctant about texting. Oh, I don't want to text. I can't give my... And when you have a discussion with them, you go, well, are you assuming we're talking about texting from your mobile phone, from your mobile phone? Why would you do that? Well, you said texting. I'm like, no, I'm just, what it is you want to
It's
deliver
just
a
a
message,
message that
right?
is
You want to,
delivered to a cell phone.
that's right. I want a message to be delivered to a cell phone. And oh, but I, what if they contact me back? Well, are you making an assumption that that message is going out from a team inbox or from an individual phone? Oh, I it's my phone, or it's just me on the computer. No, there are systems out there that are very well developed that actually allow you to very comfortably have messages go out, either you or your colleague or your staff, somebody on your behalf. And when replies come back, they come back to a group inbox. So whoever is working on Saturday and monitors it knows what's going on, but they can keep it if it's actually for your attention and move it over. There's an entire workflow process around that if thought through properly, suddenly somebody who was extremely uncomfortable communicating, say, disparate information to individual patients and getting replies back now starts realizing they are more safe. They are better protected from being overwhelmed with information at the time that they're not working, et cetera. And that's when they use the term game changer, that is really game changing in terms of one's sense of comfort. Because in healthcare, as you know, we all talk about wanting to enhance communication, and most providers, and I'll tell you, among them, almost every healthcare provider I know says, oh yeah, we need to enhance communication and we need to reduce communication. We have to reduce the either unwanted or unnecessary, overwhelming communication, stuff coming to the wrong person at the wrong time. So the tools and the way people use them have to support both making this easier and managing it at the same time. It's very interesting.
Yeah, and I know as a patient, I'm thinking like appointment reminders I get are always super helpful just to remind me, oh, I knew I had that doctor's appointment at 8 a.m., but I'm getting the reminder the day before at 8 a.m. or whatever it is, as well as broadcast messages being like, our practice is now offering the flu vaccine or whatever it is, or our practice is shut down today. There's a crazy
Exactly.
snowstorm. Like those types of messages to me as a patient via text are super easy in the sense that I have my phone on me at all times. I'm not necessarily checking my email all the time, but I have an immediate view of something that is maybe really important if I was planning on going into the practice that day. But in terms of the effort on the practice's end, they could have like messages already ready to go, and it's just, a click of a button, and it goes psh to every single one of their patients super quickly in a second. Those types of things, as you said, being making less communication overall in terms of unnecessary things, but super efficient in when an important message needs to be delivered to everyone or just an individual patient. It's not stressful for whoever it is at the practice who then needs to do it. It's a very easy automated tool that they can use.
And if people are frustrated that they don't, everything seems like it's a one-way outbound broadcast. Well, what happens when people want to reply back? Oh, that's why it says do not reply. Okay, but give me a tool that allows me to embed in the broadcast a link back to the, oh my God, they'll message us back into it more. No, have them link it back to a form. Have the form pop up and tell the person, by the way, don't do this after 2 in the morning. Have a workflow engine that restricts what can be done. So there are a lot of assumptions that we've all made because of either the constraints of existing systems, the overly healthcare-ness of the way the communication has been managed or kind of dictated, or just our training or exposure. There are assumptions that are made that lead to us making it more difficult for either patients or other providers and follow-up on consults. There are many discussions about many topics that there are still lots of barriers around, but a lot of those are based on assumptions that, well, I can't do A because I'm not allowed to do B. And someone comes along and says, actually, you could do A, B, C, D, and E. So now your job is to just just like you would in normal life. Just kind of learn how to learn what these things can do for you and then do them. I always recommend that people in healthcare settings and practices use the tools that are provided to them. This is one of the big reasons for extracting pure unified communications outside of the EMR. It can interact with the EMR where it needs to be, but I think it needs to reside above and beyond it. One of the reasons for that is because not all communication, if you're going to, just like in your normal life, you're going to use tools, I want to use them broadly, right? Not all communication is necessarily about the patients and the practice, right?
Yeah.
If something is working for the office staff to send a broadcast around the parking lot being closed for their patients, how about sending a broadcast to their endocrinologist that they interact with, or the neurosurgeons, or how about a broadcast message that reaches out and says, hey, we got an interesting case with someone in Arizona. I'm doing a telemedicine service. Anybody with, radio surgery ability available to just, pick up the phone and have a conversation. These are the ways you could be using broadcast outreach. It's the same basic workflow, and people get more familiar with it. And then they start seeing this fundamental aspects of communication as being more generic.
Yeah, so you've talked a lot about the benefits of these add-on tools, if you will, that are above and beyond what an EMR, EHR would provide in their own solution. I would think the biggest kind of barrier, if you will, to a practice adding these tools would be the additional cost and understanding, what that value brings to their practice and how it is worth it to spend this additional cost for their practice.
Yes, I think that's true. Obviously, the flip side of that is that when we look at cost, we also look at the opportunity cost of workflow. I keep getting back to faxing, because if somebody were to come to you and say, well, we have a faxing solution, which isn't just digital faxing, that's a kind of a commodity. But literally, I mean, look at the workflow process. We've made it as easy to send a fax as it is just click in a box and send an email, and you can take it back and parse it apart and separate it out and take the pages, to take these two and put in that patient record. I mean, I can go on and on about this. If that's really done well, you probably use it twice and you probably save yourself 3 hours of work. I mean, it's not even a discussion about the cost of it, right? And then the other is that, which I think is an important principle. When practices will often work to kind of develop a portal, or we have a patient portal, or we have a website, whatever, and we have forms, and this is what we do. And okay, well, why do you still have five people there to answer the phone? Well, there are a lot of people that just don't want to interact with technology and blah, 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 which is a legitimate thing. But if you were to have a consultant come in and look at it, or an economist, look at that and say, okay, so what threshold do you need to get to in order for this to become an efficiency? In other words, what's the threshold you need to get to so that you can go to your patients and go, no, this is actually how we're doing business. Well, is it 90% people, 95? And what people found during the pandemic, there was a lot of anxiety in these rural practices, for example. Oh my gosh, we can't go to, texting patients, do video chat on their phones, whatever, because our patients don't have cell phones. Well, that was based on no data. That was just an assumption. I said, well, I think you're probably going to find that the telecom companies don't think of a person as a patient. They think of them as a human being who needs a phone on their network. And so it turned out that when practices migrated to leveraging, just texting to phones or secure text, et cetera, the participation rate of the patients was much, much higher than they would have predicted. And I think there are things that happen within a practice that it's one thing to look at the cost of a particular system. It's another thing to look at the impact of that particular system. And when you start finding success at 90%, 92%, 95%, even among elderly patients or their family caregivers, if your tools make it easy for family caregivers to communicate back, well, now all of a sudden, it's not just the cost of the system that might be $50 a month or something. It's the fact that you don't have two of your staff You know, you always have to have somebody answering the phone or checking an answering machine after hours or whatever, because you don't have enough people to answer the phone. So this whole business about getting away from the phone, but being, you know, making sure people are available to talk on the phone when that's what you really have to do to be effective is really key. And I think when you look at these communication tools and their costs, you really have to look fairly broadly at costs and opportunity costs.
Yeah. So your thought is that it is worth it to spend a little money to improve the workflows, probably the work-life balance, if you will, of the people in the practice whose time and effort is being spent ensuring that they're there to answer a call if someone's calling or make sure they're following up.
If I were running a practice or advising a practice, what I would say to them is, listen, start from square one. Ask yourself, what is the most efficient way for us to function in how we communicate, what methods we use to communicate, who we communicate it with, and think broadly, right? What's the best way to do that? What's it going to cost us to do it? Then ask yourself, okay, now suppose that's not quite as pervasively accepted as we thought. How are we going to make up for the gap? You're going to have a phone, right? So, you know, right now people go, oh, we have phones. You always have a phone. You call a phone. You always give a phone number. And I'm like, okay, do you really want everybody calling you on that phone? Oh, no, that's why we're doing. So I think that it's helpful to flip this around and say that we are now in an era where, just like in behavioral health, we're now in an era where I think an awful lot of consumers and the providers, there are people coming out of training. They're probably training on telehealth. That's it. People are thinking, you know what? I'm assuming I'm going to be able to work remotely in my new job. I'm assuming I'm going to be interact with on a virtual way with my provider. Let's just figure out for the small percentage of situations where that's not quite appropriate, or once every three months we have to see each other or whatever, let's just make sure there's an effective way for handling the exceptions. Not let's look at virtual care as an exception. Let's look at it as the norm. I think that's probably how we all should be thinking about communication and virtual care, is that it's kind of the normative process now. The business model needs to correlate with that. People need to be compensated for their time online, just like they should always have been compensated for having to manage a 70-page fax. That's my view, right? I think you should always have been paid for the amount of time that it's taking for your practice to manage inbound information. And because if that's the case, then when someone comes along and says, oh, well, we found a way to make this 200 times more efficient, everybody has a vested interest in that being the case. So it's interesting.
Yeah. And are there specific specialties that you would say would especially benefit from enhanced communication tools?
I can't imagine a specialty in medicine. I can't imagine one that is not benefiting and seeks to benefit both their patients and their colleagues and themselves from much more efficient, effective communication. I just, from a malpractice and a medical legal perspective and a workflow efficiency perspective and a customer engagement and customer retention so many ways. I mean, it's really hard. It's hard to imagine. I mean, when you look at the field of telehealth and virtual care, I mean, there are surgical specialties that are doing a lot of online virtual consultative work, and people would think it's impossible. But I mean, heck, I did stroke care with a lot of other people, and we were giving clot busting drugs to people without ever laying hands on them. Now, you may be working with intermediaries in the middle, but the reality is that everybody started to think differently about the nature. What is the nature of a neurologic evaluation when you can't physically be in the room? The reality is there is a new model of how to do that.
Yeah.
And in many ways, it's probably more effective. It's hard to think of an area of healthcare that is not dramatically benefiting from enhanced communication.
Yeah, that's a great example too, because I know you've told me before in the past that you were doing stroke evaluations via telehealth, which, as you said, is a crazy thing to think about, can be super effective if done right, following the right procedures.
The most important thing in a telehealth evaluation for somebody with an acute neurologic event is the first 2 minutes of conversation face to face with sound that's working with either the patient or a family caregiver or someone who knows them. The first 2 minutes, you already have a 95%, you know, surety level of what you think you're actually dealing with, and the rest of your exam and et cetera is to just confirm some things and to look for the rare surprise. And so it is, even that is fundamentally communication. I think surgeons will tell you the same thing. It's the first 2 to 5 minutes of questioning about the nature of symptoms, history, the attitude of someone, their facial expression, you know, lots of things that makes all the difference.
Yeah, so we've talked about a good amount of things, but I think to summarize, at least from my point of view, that these additional communication tools not only increase engagement with patients, which would, you know, decrease no-shows for appointments, but also likely make these patients feel really supported and ideally happy to stay with the practice long-term, be a patient for a long time, but also allow the practice to communicate very effectively with hospitals, health systems, all of the other co-workers, if you will, that are outside the practice that are ensuring the ultimate goal of this patient's care. Can you speak a little bit to how those tools helped you work with hospitals and health systems in addition to the patients themselves?
Yeah. So I think the whole area of we can call it inter-provider communications, is actually something that's it's actually quite challenging. In many ways, you could argue that patients, you know, when patients have a relationship to a particular provider, they may have relationships to multiple providers. The patients have multiple systems and methods and portals and whatever. But when it comes to inter-provider communication, it can be profoundly inefficient. I remember talking to people who went to some famous medical institution, and this was not the Mayo Clinic, because I can tell you the Mayo Clinic to me is the model of operational efficiency, but who said, wow, it's amazing. Everybody's so smart, but the people on the second floor aren't talking to the people on the third floor, or the doctors are so busy, or they're not being compensated for their time. And they literally are wandering around rounding on 30 patients and everybody assumes you put a note in the chart and that's your way of communicating. And holy cow. I mean, that lots of things fall through the wayside in the process. So when being able to reach out to the radiologist when you have a question on a case, and that can be done efficiently and timely, and if they're not available, someone else is who can follow through, etc. When that works, there is no going back from that. It is a radical change in your level of your sense of safety, your sense of collegiality, your sense of support. Medical care is complicated. Patients are complicated. Things as simple as, I'd like to get can I get a copy of the discharge note from, I heard, oh, wow. Okay, the patient shows up. They think they know the hospital they were in. You have to call through the medical records department. You're not on staff there. Who are you? How are we going to validate it? Well, we don't send things by email. I'm sorry. I'm like, I have this person who just told me they were in your hospital. With the answer you usually get is the staff ends up calling the staff and somebody will agree to fax it. And I'm like, I kind of laugh, you know, faxing. But it's very time consuming. It's very inefficient. And, if I go on a health system's website and there's some, you know, big fancy institution, and when I look at the name of a doc and I can see their bio, whatever, what's the one thing I'm looking for? Is there a button I can click to reach this person? Oh, well, you know, they're busy. They're in clinic. You have to call thing. What I was looking for, and I can assure you that's a pretty ubiquitous situation, right? And all the tools exist to be able to do exactly that, to be able to find that person's name on their webpage, and whatever intermediaries are in the middle, whatever sits in between that person, however busy they are, whatever. I'm a consumer at that point in time. And I do think that one of the ways of looking at this is that at any moment in time, healthcare providers are also consumers, and they are, I'm a consumer relative to that hospital. That hospital has something I need from them, even if it's relating to a patient or that specialist does, etc. Specialists are seeing patients and, you know, the patient walks in without enough information. They really need the last three, you know, progress notes and some lab results from the referring doctor, because the fundamental process of finding that person, connecting with them, and getting the information you want quickly for whatever multitude of reasons, some legitimate, some absurd, right? What happens as a result? Oh, okay. Because we know that's so efficient, every time a patient gets referred here, I want the patient to fill out the 5-page form. I want all this stuff sent. I want this stuff faxed, have it printed out, bring it on the CD. You know, you've introduced tremendous inefficiency to a routine process, because the basic routine communication transaction has just been, it's just not effective. And when when it does work, it's just a godsend. It's just, I can give you examples of literally being given consults, and the first thing I would do, if my colleagues would get on video and try to connect to the robot and, you know, whatever, I could give you stories, you know, galore. First thing I would do is, what was the name of the emergency room doctor? And I'd find them on, you know, Tiger, Perfect Sir, I don't care what this of the Epic Chat, if they use that, that's great. And right, and if in 2 minutes or 1 minute I hear back, yes, I am the doctor. Yes, that is the patient. Actually, we don't really need you urgently right now. They're off getting a scan and I got some more information from the family. That in and of itself, that 1 minute communication just saved everyone like oodles of time and resources, and the ability to connect between institutions, between providers, among providers, has a really profound impact on the efficiency of everything else that's going on downstream. And because we don't have it so often, there's a lot of resources and time expended, just assuming that it won't. And I can assure you the amount of, you know, we were doing video consults and everybody, when in fact, in my opinion, what we really needed to be doing was just secure text interaction with people who had a clinical question. And then if it turns out that we needed to get a video, okay, fine. Now it's worth having somebody go down to the third floor, get the cart, but we'll see you at 4 o'clock.
And this is my last question. If you were talking to a new person entering the medical field or a practice that doesn't really utilize communications effectively, what would you say are just the top benefits for a robust communications system digitally for a practice?
Number one, we're in a changing world. We're in a more consumer-oriented economy. Do not make assumptions. Do not make assumptions that because insurance companies won't pay for something that you can't get paid for it. That's a bad assumption to make, right? You can make a decision to be completely constrained by what insurance companies will reimburse you for, but given the mindset of your customers, you're literally leaving money on the table. I mean, it's just ridiculous. I mean, patients are human beings. They're beginning to understand that, you know, I do something, I order it, it gets delivered to my house, the food gets sent to my house, I realize there's an extra tip involved. That's just the way that it works, right?
Yeah.
So don't make assumptions around the business model, is one. And two, my general advice is that if you start with a strategy around communication, in other words, just focus first on how to maximize the efficiency of both what you send out, what you communicate out, what is communicated into you, who's actually involved. Just really think about it, right? Think you could throw some pictures up, just like your family tree, and focus first on solving for that. I think it has an impact on what you even look for in your EMR or your other systems or, you know, or whatever. You know, you may have decided to have a separate file sharing system as opposed to someone going, well, file sharing is just an extension of communication. Suppose every time I send files to and receive files from people, they text it back to me. It goes into a repository and I can access that. Oh, I didn't realize. I thought we needed a separate one of those. So I think that I guess those would be two things is start with this thinking about a communication plan, not as an add-on, but as a fundamental element, and then assume that your business model can actually map to communications, because patients, and in particular, and family members of patients, they are paying for convenience. And in healthcare, I think communication is just so fundamental to that question about convenience.
Yeah. Well, awesome. This has been super informative. I really appreciate you coming on the podcast to talk about this today, Dr. Barbash.
Thank you for listening to today's episode. To learn more, please visit us at drcrono.com.